To better understand their world, Florida Crystals granted CBS4 News access to their fields and facilities, and you quickly realize how much farming has changed.
So here are satellite images that we download from NASA to look at the health of the crop.
Diego Luzuriaga is the head of research and development at Florida Crystals.
So when we go to the website, NASA's website, we pull these images every 2 weeks. The image looks like this. To the naked eye, you see probably nothing there.
They then analyze the images and color code various patterns.
So green means the crop is doing well. It's healthy, it's growing, actively growing. Yellow means, hey, we have an issue. There's something happening to the crop, lack of water, maybe a disease, a pest. Something that alerts us that we need to go and see the field and take action. We're moving into drone technology, and with drones you can go down to 2 inches, 3 inches, where you can see, yeah, one plant is green, the other plant is yellow.
Gone are the thousands of machete-wielding immigrants who came every year from Jamaica and the Caribbean for the annual sugar harvest. Today, the work is done by giant computer-guided harvesters.
The machine drives by itself on a straight line.
The machine drives by itself?
In a straight line. Correct, using GPS technology and with about an inch accuracy. So they will move back and forth within an inch of a line that we've predefined in that field.
And that's based on what, you got a satellite?
With satellite data, GPS information, that we have a network throughout the farm to be able to achieve that.
The operator who sits in the cab controls the speed so the trucks that run alongside the harvester can collect the cane and deliver it to the mills.
This is a long way from a bunch of guys with machetes out in the field.
That's technology, bringing technology into agriculture.
It is also a long way from how the Fanjul family first started growing sugar 150 years ago in Cuba. After Fidel Castro rose to power, the family fled to the United States and started over in the Everglades, forming Florida Crystals. Today, the company is controlled by two brothers, Alfie and Pepe. They are believed to have a combined net worth approaching $1 billion. CBS4 News requested an interview with the Fanjuls. Initially, we were told Alfie Fanjul would speak to us. Then we were told we would have to first meet him off camera to discuss it. But after months of requests by CBS4 News, the meeting never occurred. Back out in the field, while the technology behind the growing sugarcane has changed, other parts of the business are no different than they were 50 years ago. And as they have since the beginning, every sugar harvest starts with fire.
We burn basically to get the cane, the trash off the cane, so we don't leave the trash in the field.
The trash is the leaves. The fire burns the leaves, but not the stalk, because the stalk is essentially a combination of water and sucrose, the liquid form of sugar. All the cane growers care about is what's inside the stalk. From October through May, smoke plumes fill the skies. Residents in the area call it black snow, a fine coating of soot that lands on their cars and homes. The Sierra Club has mounted a campaign to end the burning, claiming it affects air quality. The sugar companies dispute it and continue to receive state permits to burn. The sugar giants don't have to burn. They could deal with the leaves in different ways, but that would be more expensive.
When we leave the trash in the field with the cooler temperatures we got and the poorly drained fields we get, they stay wet too long. So if we don't burn it, then we have to cultivate it a lot more. We have to burn a lot more fuel, 30-35% more fuel to harvest it and to farm it.
From the field, the stalks are moved to the mill.
The first process is shredding the cane, then we mill the cane. The cane is milled between heavy rollers to extract the maximum amount of juice. You know, we add hot water in the last mill, so that way we can recover the maximum amount of sucrose.
The cane is 75% water, 13% sucrose, and 12% fiber.
Our goal is to recover the sucrose, which is in the cane, make sugar, okay? The fiber is recovered as bagasse, and we burn that in our boilers to generate steam, you know, for our process and to make electricity for our own use and also to sell to the grid.
The mill itself can be overpowering when you first see it. An industrial complex with miles of pipes, as well as thousands of gauges, levers, and valves. It is loud and hot, and has a sickening sweet smell to it.
Making sugar historically used to be an art, so we apply a lot of technology to it today, a lot of science.
The sucrose is boiled in massive vats, becoming molasses.
What the operator is doing is taking a sample and then visually checking it to make sure that the process is working well.
By controlling pressure and temperature, they can cause the crystals to be formed in the molasses.
This is the molasses?
This is the molasses. Gritty. So go ahead and do it like that. You can feel the crystals in it?
Yeah. It's hot.
It's boiling about 147 degrees. This is a very small crystal. We're going to grow this crystal to about 600 to 700 microns in size. And then, so this crystal will be a lot larger than what it is now.
And those are the crystals that we see in sugar?
Exactly.
Once the crystal grows to the right size, it needs to be separated from the molasses using a centrifuge. Spun at a high speed, the molasses is forced through tiny holes, leaving the sugar crystals behind. That raw sugar can be stored in warehouses until it is ready to be refined and packaged for sale. From the tiny packets at coffee shops and diners to industrial-sized bags for commercial bakers.
Over here, we produce 50-pound, 25-pound, 10-pound, 5-pound, 4-pound, 2-pound browns, retail browns powder, retail powder, industrial brown, industrial powder, canisters, and then we also sell liquid sugar in bulk tankers to customers that use in their packaging plants.
Like what? Like who?
Coke, Pepsi, Publix.
The packing plant is almost entirely automated, a conga line of bagged sugar that occasionally goes awry, but for the most part, never misses a beat. Bags stacked and wrapped and ready for delivery.
We ship anywhere between 70 and 80 trucks on average a day.